Welcome back. Let's just wait for the speaker, Mr. Balaji. So once he's back, he will start. Others can mute because let's say for first few minutes, okay, he will be finishing up his session, and then we can join for question answer session. Yeah, Balaji.
I will finish with lecture, my talk in not more than 10 minutes. So
please.
More minutes and I will
no issues. No issues.
Because I realize that I am talking for a long time.
No, it's just perfect. It's just essential. That's absolutely fine. Absolutely fine. No issue.
All right. No problem, sir.
All right.
Well, go ahead.
Achha. So I will then begin. So let me share the screen again. So I am allowed to share the screen?
Yeah. Very much. Yeah.
Okay.
Visible.
So I was talking about that IIT PAL Physics. So what I want to say is that this is a very good initiative, because you know that most of us, even from Maharashtra, for getting into IIT coaching, we go to coaching classes in Kota, etc. Now I have nothing to make any comment about how good or bad that is. What I feel is that those who can do it, it's fine. But this IIT PAL, wherein you get lectures about the 11th and 12th standard physics, these are very, I listened to a couple of them, and I find that it is done very well. It is actually very good as a compensating material for learning from the book. 11th standard, 12th standard book concepts, they have been very detailedly explained in these lectures. For example, here, this is this professor, H.C. Verma. He has, by the way, got some Padma Bhushan or Padma Vibhushan award also in the last 1 year or so, and that he has developed these lectures. This is an IIT activity, so it is done through the IIT system. And here, for example, these conductors, semiconductors, insulator, etc., he has explained it very lucidly. So it is actually much more detailed than what is explained in the book. So if you read the book, you will probably not understand, but you should watch these videos and you will understand it. So there's a great benefit to following this, whatever material is available. And then the even the online books, e-books, they are available on this website, etc. This has been done, I think, due to corona pandemic and so on. So, yeah. And then there are even, if you are in BSc or MSc, again, there are very nice courses. For example, this is Professor Ahluwalia, who is giving lectures on statistical mechanics. So, I mean, you don't know, but at least when I was doing my MSc, I would say that I miss this. I feel very sorry about it, that we had no option. So such quality teaching now is available. So this flattens the world. It doesn't make any difference whether you are from rural India or you are from Pune, Mumbai, Delhi. So this disparity, it takes away, and this is a very big thing. This is very, very big thing. So I think one should make full use of it. Then NPTEL, so they have their many engineering courses, etc. They are also of very good quality. And so I think that teaching quality problem, that fifth challenge of learning Indian physics, I think that has, I would say, has been adequately tackled. This is how I would put it. So then with this, there is also this concept of blended teaching. That's what they do. But let me just skip it. I think it's not that important. So I have explained the crux of it already. And this also let me explain. So let me come to this very important slide, this one and the next one. So these are my last two slides. So here I have, I think this also we have done. I just put it back because I wanted to bring the continuity. And here we see, so these are the strengths and these are the challenges. So now I would like to go over to the next slide and make some advice regarding the career, keeping in mind the strengths and the challenges that a physicist or physics involve. So let's look here. So it has been titled as possible educational career strategies and opportunities. Now, see, one career possibility is that you want to do hardcore physics. When do you do that? You do that when you are immensely swayed by these two points, that this allows you to have very accurate and rigorous understanding of physical processes in nature, and you are swayed by it. And the second part, that it is actually a mother subject to all the technologies, etc. I think this is good enough for a very significant number of students to be impressed and to devote themselves to physics. So if they are impressed by it, and then they say that come what may, whatever challenges are there, I will face them, whatever it may be, whatever the consequences may be, I will tackle it and I will choose physics. So if you are in that state of mind, then you go for 11th, 12th standard physics, you take part in Olympiad, CNTSC, KVPI, this Kishore Vaigyanik Yojana, Protsahan Yojana or something like that. Then you do your BSc or BS in physics. Then you do MSc or MS in physics. Those who can go abroad can go abroad, etc. Then you do PhD, postdoc, etc. So that would be a typical educational career strategy that you would follow. And the prospects would be that you become a faculty member in these elite institutes or in state and private universities, colleges, or you would become a scientist in these government laboratories or PSUs or industrial research and development. Although still in India, we don't have so much of industrial R&D for physics, at least. In pharmaceuticals, in chemistry, I think that is better. The situation is better. But you never know. I mean, things should begin to change, and I do believe that these things will change. I would also put it that it is possible to become an entrepreneur too. You can manufacture equipments, components, or device, etc. And there is a potential. So these are the possibilities when you have this, you want to do hardcore physics. But I mean, one has also to be realistic. Not everybody can be so, I would say, so reckless in a way that he will say, no, I will put my life for physics. That you shouldn't expect it for everybody. Somebody may say that, no, I want to be more realistic. And in the end, he might say that, okay, I am impressed by physics, but then I also want to be realistic about my own capabilities and whatever, his own life situation and like that. And for that, I have a couple of suggestions here. So it is like a little bit safer approach, not so much of risk, let's say. See, you can, one is that from being a physicist, you turn into an engineer. So you are doing BSc or BS. After that, you can do MCA. And then that is a way in which you can become a software engineer. Couple of Ajinkians have done that, for example, and have been very successful. In fact, they have become entrepreneurs in a way. Balshetwar from our batch, for example, has apparently followed this strategy. You could do BSc, MSc, then you can do M.Tech, and then you are again back to being an engineer in a way. So if you want to, why going from physics to engineer? So that, let's say, you have better career opportunities, etc. So that was the intention. Then let's say that after 12th standard, you actually liked physics. You know, in our society, we still have that pressure that we want to go to engineering, medical, etc. So you still went to engineering, for example, although your heart was for physics, but you went to engineering. Now, I can tell you that it is possible to come back. So you did your engineering, by that time the student has grown up, he has become mature, he has seen little bit more of world, and then he says, Nana, I want to go back to physics. That is possible. So after BE, BTech, you are most of the universities, at least the good universities, reputed universities, they will allow you to sit for MSc, MS entrance exam. You can get back, you clear that exam, and which is not a very impossible prospect. A decent student of a BE, BTech can also crack this MSc entrance exam, he come back to being MSc physics and become a physicist, and then he can get back to this track, let's say. So that was for this. It is also possible to do, let's say, BSc. So he was originally a physicist and get into life science stream. So you do BSc and then you get into MSc biophysics or MTech biotechnology or pharmacology, etc. And this is also a very good prospect, I would say. And you can go even into from physics to chemistry. And because chemistry, pharmacology, etc., they apparently have better employment possibilities even in our own country also. And let me tell you that if you go from physics to these subjects, you do have a unique advantage. So you will be able to contribute much. Here, even in this, let's say you have become a biotechnologist or you have become a biophysicist, you even can get do very well in the entrepreneurship also. There also there are very good opportunities. And at least in this biotechnology, etc., even in our own country, I think this is not that bad. So for physics entrepreneurship, it might be little tip, but I think in biotechnology, etc., people are doing very well. And with a physics background, you can significantly, you can even contribute much better than a hardcore biologist. That definitely is possible. So, and between physics and chemistry, I would call it is possible to interchange, go back from one stream to other and like that. So with this, what I want to point out is that doing physics is actually an enabler. You can, from physics, you can become a biologist. The other way might turn out to be difficult. So so these are also some points which I want to advise you as possible career opportunities, and also to point it out to you that don't neglect your physics. Physics is going to help you even if you want to become a biologist or an engineer, etc. And especially if you want to become an entrepreneur in these fields, physics might actually be an enabler. It might be a helping hand to you. So I think this was my last slide. And with that, I would more or less, I think I'm at the end. And this is my last slide where I want to again thank the organizers of this online lecturing series, Yogesh sir and Shashikant sir. And I also want to thank my own batchmate, Deepak, because I shared this presentation with him and he gave a very detailed, profound feedback on this. And I also thank you all for your patient hearing, and now I hand over the control to Yogesh sir.
Thanks Balaji. I appreciate, and we all appreciate, a very balanced presentation, a different outlook to the basic science and specifically physics. I am so sure and confident all have enjoyed this lecture, or maybe not a lecture, but more of a presentation and an idea sharing concept, because we believe in theory of giving. You go on giving, you will get more. So something of that, whatever you had, you are giving it back to us with a different angle to it. And I open the session for question and answer. And I think people will take benefit of this question and answer session as well. Please.
You might want to stop sharing your screen.
We have a very senior Ajinkyan today here. Sochi sir, he has a question. I think he will ask the question. Please.
Yeah, Balaji, can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Yes sir.
Okay. Very interesting talk, and learned a lot of new things. I just want to know one thing. You have just given out the courses which are available in India, right?
Yes.
Free courses.
Yes.
But yes, there are n number of courses being offered by, you know, universities like Harvard and Oxford and Cambridge and Khan.
Yes.
And edX. What is your input on that? because it carries a lot of weight, and they also give certificates.
Yes, yes.
But I'm myself undergoing one of the courses, so that is what I know.
Yes. Yeah, yeah. Sir, I would like to say that those courses that you mentioned from Western universities, they are definitely also of high quality. I just wanted to bring about the Indian contribution. That's why I just stuck to it. But I would say once you get used to it, you will of course also come to know of the other things. This MIT OpenWare or so many others are also there. And how many of them are free? How many of them really charge some money? That I'm not aware of. But they are also of very good quality. Many of them might even be better. But even among the Indian ones, most of them are also very good. Not all of them necessarily are good. One has to be a little bit choosy. But I would still say that, for example, this IIT PAL, which I mentioned, that I think is very unique. And then there are some courses. And I should also mention that the way Indian teachers teach, it has also got its own flavor. So for the Indian student population, a good Indian teacher teaching has got that sense of familiarity and etc. So it has got its own benefit. But I have also deep respect about the quality of the courses from the Western countries that you have mentioned.
No, I just wanted to add that most of these courses abroad, they are video presentations, and the presentation is absolutely fabulous, so you can understand it. I have not really seen Indian institutions or colleges imparting this training, so I won't know. So you are a better person to compare and advise youngsters. See, basically, it's the youngsters whom we need to advise and guide them as to what they should know. So they are nowadays capable of understanding things and planning own career.
Yes, yes, yes.
Balaji. I would like to add on. Okay, say it is not only about physics, okay, but then physics and math being the toughest subject for Indian students, okay, rely more because and like say every subject which is being taught in our education system, okay, it is not purely application based, okay, but then universities which are there abroad, okay, they have the application based learning, okay, so the education system is different. That's why, it's become interesting and all. So, but then, as you mentioned, okay, as you have highlighted so many things very clearly, okay, which subject is relevant to which career, okay? So, if that thing can be elaborated by the teachers and professors, then obviously, people will have, develop interest for physics. Otherwise, people will not have interest for physics. So, you can share your experience. You must have done this thing to attract students, right?
Yeah, yeah. So here I would like to make the following comment that those IIT PAL lectures by Professor Verma, which I mentioned, I found them to be extremely useful, even from the application point of view, which you are trying to emphasize, and also as a complementary material, as well as supplementary material to the NCERT textbooks. In fact, just by reading book, I got a feeling that I am not fully satisfied with what is written in the book, but the corresponding concepts or the topics, the way this professor has explained, he has taken pains to really derive things, tell where the applications are. My advice would be that just try, and this Professor Verma's YouTube videos are available on YouTube also. Just go into that conductor, semiconductor, metal topic, you go through it, in 10 minutes you will understand that this is a very useful video lecture which will definitely motivate a student to learn physics. I am fairly confident of it. So I think this is what this is what I would like to say.
Right.
Like, are you supported by in the video also? So what you're saying, IIT professor doing that, it is an advocated process which is adopted, and they have been online courses right from before us, and we started a couple of years back, but from there it has been a trend which has been quite back.
I mean, see, it only increases your choice. That's what I would say. And for the 11th, 12th standard, see, a typical Indian student will have a NCERT book, he will read. And now for the a corresponding video lecture, which will complement him in studying that NCERT book, you would have to, I would go to this Professor Verma's video lectures to be able to understand my textbook of NCERT physics. So in that way, I think this Professor Verma's YouTube videos have a unique advantage. The other videos from Western countries might even be better. They might be even of high quality, etc. But as far as that Indian student is concerned, these YouTube videos from Professor Verma have got a unique relevance. This is how I would put it. So, I mean, and once you get the hang of it, once you get to, once you get deeper, slightly deeper into this subject, of course you go to other videos available in the web from Western countries, whatever, and you go deep as you want. In fact, that is what is expected also.
Balaji, I have a question.
Yes.
Okay. See, physics and math, as I mentioned earlier also, are like a toughest subject for all the students. Okay. Except because
yes,
it's my experience that, let's say, students from Latur gang, okay, they used to be very, very good in math, specifically math. Okay. And because they were good in math, okay, they were.
How to develop that kind of, let's say, interest among, let's say, physics and math subject?
So can you repeat your question? I got that students from rural background, from Latur, etc., they used to be good in maths. So that part I understood, but your final question I couldn't get.
Yeah, actually what I said, like say, if we need to develop interest among physics and math subject, okay, from the student, okay, so what would be the, like say, method to develop that interest or to maybe make them interesting, okay, to study physics or maths?
See, I mean, how you make a student to develop interest in maths
and
well,
physics?
I didn't really think too much. Physics, I would say, is like, see, and you see, in a way, you have to also accept this reality that not all will be interested in physics or all will be interested in maths. You have to give that chance to everybody also. You don't want everybody to be interested in physics, maths. They will not be. So don't force anybody. If he's not interested in physics and maths, please don't force him, because this is also a very, this I don't think will have very positive consequences. So you expose him. If he develops interest, and one more thing, and why I say this, you agree with me that students from rural background also have a knack for physics, for mathematics. So if they have knack for mathematics, you really don't have to do, and that if a rural student has a knack for mathematics, has an aptitude for mathematics, you should actually be happy. It means that you don't really have to do much. If so this is something God given, I mean, what your aptitude is, so you just accept it. I would rather go by that. And even if, let's say, of the total population, student population we have, even if 10% develop that aptitude or have that aptitude, that I would say is not a bad thing. Anyway, I mean, if I look at it that way, not many are opting for physics, etc. Even in good places like Pune, where there are very good teachers, etc., I think the physics courses apparently are not very popular. So it is not that all those who have the knack for maths, forget about trying more students to have aptitude for maths. I think many already have, but even those who have maths, not all of them are inclined to take a higher course in physics. That is what is the trouble. This is how I would put it. So, and anyway, I mean, I don't have an idea as to how a school child math should he should develop aptitude for maths for a school child. I don't know, or I didn't think about it much. Let me say that.
Balaji, I have one question. Balaji,
yes.
As like we all have studied basic sciences till our 10th or 12th, And what I remember, we had practicals for these subjects from 9th onwards or so. So would it not be a better idea in an education system to have this kind of practical sessions from 6th standard or so, so which will give us an inclination of a student, whether he's looking for physics or chemistry or biology, so where he can be exposed to more practical trainings and obviously develop his career or maybe develop his passion.
Yeah, I mean, I would say that, so your question was that there should be practical training so that he develops
a little early from 6th standard rather than 8th or 9th standard, that I mean.
Could even with that, I mean, there are also government is even trying to develop some virtual laboratories, etc. And these textbooks, I don't know, even the 6th, 7th, 8th standard textbook might also be of very improved quality these days. And so it might have been helpful. So it could be. One thing I like, or to that point, what I would say is that it would be good idea if there are, let's say, private facilities. For example, in a place like Pune, there could be private institutions which allow students to perform experiments. This might be a good idea. So let them charge some money, let them make a business out of it. But I think this would be a good idea to the point that you mentioned.
Balaji, see, as you mentioned, let's say some private institute should come up with such kind of experiments and all. They should allow them to go for experiments. So recently, let's say, I have come up with the same idea. I am going to establish one project in Pune. It talks about, like, say, all science and math subjects. We are going to give the learning through exhibits. So it's going to be like the students will be applying their knowledge on those experiments, and like say they will learn that concept through exhibits.
In
European and Western countries, they are like say having the science centers. So we are coming up with that kind of module. So hope so, like say it may get success.
Yes, in fact, I would say is a very good initiative, not only for school children, but I must say that even for research, etc., this concept can actually be taken over.
Right.
Reason being that many times that these facilities are not optimally utilized, and if, for example, there is a private player in this who has, let's say, only one facility, but then he makes it he runs it in a private way, and let's say one scientific instrument, and then he is good at it, he purchases it, and then he runs it as a on a commercial basis, I think this will be win-win for the scientific community as well as for that person who is running it. So this can even be taken over for degree courses, for research, etc. I think this is a good way of solving that problem.
I think Dhanesh Shep has some question. He's smiling.
Nay, sir, actually, he has told that one can shift from one subject to another subject. I am the live example here. I have done my BSc in chemistry and physics. But I have done my post-graduation in pharmacology, which Balaji has already mentioned.
Oh, great. Good.
So after
we
BSc,
already have
I
two examples.
After BSc, I have done my medical pharmacology. That's a course of 3.5 years, which is done in the medical colleges. On the basis of that, post-graduation course, you can become professor in medical college, you can become professor in dental college, or
pharmacy
you can also
college.
Join the pharma industry.
Pharma
industry. And I have gone through all these three departments. I was a professor in dental college also. I was professor in the medical college also. And currently, I am working in the pharma industry.
Good. So
multitasking. And still, these courses are going on. Only thing is that only one seat is there per university. Only one seat is there. And even after doing BSc chemistry, or even after doing BAMS or BHMS, or BDS also, they can do this course.
You mean to say, like say, Ajinkyas are exception?
Actually,
Balaji, one more question.
Yes.
Sorry. You can continue.
I want to add a short comment. Actually, you know that to be frank, it is also my honest opinion that choosing this first option, this what I said, hardcore physics, wherein right. you choose this track and you try to become a faculty member and all that, I must admit to you that this is really a very daunting task, fraught with lot of risk, because I have seen people who have done all very excellent career, they have done postdoc, etc. in reputed universities in USA. India. So you imagine a situation that the gentleman or that candidate has done all, everything nice and he is still finding tough to get back. So in a way, I mean, being swayed by physics and all that is fine. But one should also be mindful that there are risks involved in that. I mean, one should still take risk. That is true. What and as a in connection with that, disciplinary thing, wherein you go from physics to these elite subjects like biotechnology or pharmacology like that. That is actually is a very prudent strategy. That is, I think, definitely true, because you have coming from physics background, you have that very unique capability, and then you land up in so it is like it becomes low hanging fruit wherein you are unique, so you increase your sellability, etc. So this is indeed a good strategy. I would also very much recommend it.
Can I interrupt for a minute?
I think Sanjay Mane does have some question. He has raised some questions in the chat.
Can I interrupt, gentlemen, for a minute? Hello?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yes.
Yeah, I am sorry I have to leave. There's another pair engagement for another web seminar. Thank you so much, Balaji.
Thank you. We have left out with last 9 minutes, so we can take few more questions and then we can wind up.
Okay, yes. And I just want to know, have you got this earlier webs recorded?
Yeah.
Yes, access to that?
Yes. I'll share it with you sometime.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Good night. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for participating. Bye.
Sir, I have a question. Can I ask?
Yeah, you had a question.
Ganesh, sir. Can I ask a question, sir?
Yeah. Go ahead.
Yes, go ahead.
Balaji sir, I am Ganesh Yevle sir. I am younger brother of your batchmate Kishor Yevle.
Okay. Yes.
So presently I am in Air Force. Sir, I wanted to submit one thing, that the career opportunities that have been told and that are available outside in the open domain is not actually being explored in school. In school, that is in our school, generally attention is given to NDA and defense services. I 100% agree to that, sir, that the core motive of our school is to send maximum people into defense services, and we being so. But the point is that, like you said, that the person has to be exposed to the the career opportunities in physics or whatever we are talking now. Actually, had that been given in our school days, certainly the result would have been different. And the clarity in career making and career building, actually after 12th, if you don't join NDA or defense services, you generally get lost for some time if you don't have a good mentor. I think mentorship should be there, sir. You being such a senior and explored, there will be many, but I feel that we should contribute going back to the school and having some sessions in explaining the students or school students that career outside defense forces. One odd session maybe.
Ganesh.
That is all, sir.
Ganesh. Sir. Yeah. See, we have when we started these virtual sessions, okay, we have decided to, like say, continue it throughout the year. Okay, maybe once in a week or maybe once in a, like say, a fortnight. And we are going to have it even for schools also. because there are so many experts, okay, which are available in the Ajinkan fraternity. So we are going to give it back, okay, through this kind of session, so that, like, say, students who are studying there, okay, they should be exposed to the different career options, but then not before, like, say, they appear for the first NDA chance. It will be post that.
Yes, exactly, sir, because then only he'll be able to have a second career. Maybe, absolutely. Yes, absolutely. Everybody has a first option as NDA. Okay, understood, sir. But second, right. Third, he should have, so that he doesn't get lost. So yes, generally, yes. What happens, sir, when I was in school, at least in 20 years back, so the situation was that only NDA and Defense Services, that was told. So generally, there was nothing else. And if at all, by any chance, if he misses it, then there is a blank screen on in front of him. Until right. Unless he has got some good mentor. And like that time, we didn't have such a good WhatsApp and this platforms. Now, being that we are connected, sir, I think this should be a better. And your idea is certainly good, sir, to make a library of these type of sessions, career opportunities, and post it to the school fraternity so that they can at least watch it. And now that platform is available for all the students.
Right. Yeah, no, last question, because let's say we have left out with very few minutes. So, last question.
Sanjay Mane. Yes. Sanjay Mane had a question, right?
Yeah, he raised some questions on chat.
Yeah, astrophysics. He was asking about astro. Sanjay, you are there, right? Sanjay?
I think, sir, he has left.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
So I think then Amol can ask some questions. Amol Naikodi from his batch can ask him some questions.
Sir, I just wanted to ask nothing just for Balaji, sir. Can you just share any Kundiva or Dadiva law?
right.
We don't have. That was the complaint of the teacher, that we don't have any Dhondivas and Kondivas law like we have by Sayawad law. So he was complaining about that.
On a serious note, sir, do you feel that since Western has more impact on our physics syllabus, so do you feel that our own scientist who are, means other than S.C. Bose and C.V. Raman, any other could have been there in our syllabus book, which could have been much more inspirational for our local...
Maji Chappal?
No, my opinion is that I think things have been reasonably fair. I mean, what you could say is Satyendranath Bose, I think his contribution was very phenomenal. But that has already gone into textbook. See, so to that extent, it has been fair. I mean, somebody might say that he should have been given Nobel Prize. Yeah, could be. I mean, I would have been very happy if he would have also won a Nobel Prize, because his contribution is extremely phenomenal. But even if he has not got Nobel Prize, he has already entered all the textbooks. That is, so for eternity, he is in the textbooks now. So that way, I think science is fairly fair. So I would say that these days, if you make a contribution, it is taken note of, and it is not possible to suppress it because you are from this area or that area. That might be a little bit of difficulties, but I think there is no serious discrimination. So I think that is not anymore an issue.
Yeah, one minute. Just out of box thought.
Sir, last because like we have left out with 1 minute,
Oh, okay. Then, sir, another one. Then I will not ask. You can.
Just an out of box thought. If Ajinkya can make Hockrat out of hockey and cricket, let's make this Dhondiba and Kondiba laws also. That can be a challenge taken by Ajinkya.
right.
No, I think we should actually what the initiatives that. Shashikant sir, and I think he was trying to set up these experimental laboratories on private basis.
Yeah.
I think is a very timely initiative. This might be even the need of the time, and this might be very beneficial. And I think Science School Ajinkyan community can really contribute, because I remember from my one of the previous lectures that one professor Ajinkyan is there as professor in the MIT college also. So yeah. There might be many lecturers of physics and other science subjects, etc. And this, I think, can be everybody's expertise can be pulled together and can be put to good use.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Balaji.